like to introduce to you Dave Sanderson.
Tonight, Miracle on the Hudson. A jetliner filled with passengers crashes in the frigid waters off Manhattan, and everyone on board survives.
U.S. Airways Flight 1549 had just taken off from LaGuardia Airport in Queens for Charlotte, North Carolina, when it apparently hit a flock of birds, knocking out both of the plane's engines.
Cactus 1539 hit birds.
Cactus 1529, turn right 280. You can land runway 1 at Teterboro.
We can't do it.
Even without power, though, the pilots managed to maneuver the Airbus A320 northward over the Bronx, make a sharp turn south, then follow the Hudson River alongside Manhattan Island, losing altitude along the way, and finally coming to rest on the river.
The plane then skimmed across the water 100 yards or more before coming to a rest just off Midtown Manhattan.
Many passengers didn't think they'd make it. One man turned his cell phone on so his body could be found through the phone's GPS. A woman left a message for her husband. Tell the kids I love them. Joining me now is David Sanderson. He was one of the last passengers out of the plane. And I understand you were actually in the plane after it landed for 7 minutes. Was it filling up with water?
Yeah, once we got everybody out, I stood in the plane to make sure everybody was out. And it was filling up pretty rapidly and got up to about waist level. And then when everybody was out in the lifeboats, I then stepped out on the edge there, and it was about knee deep at that point. And I just jumped in and started trying to swim to the first boat I could find.
Chesley B. Sullenberger III, a former fighter pilot, used 40 years of experience to somehow land the powerless plane on the icy waters of the Hudson River, a feat that's being called a miracle.
Dave, take me inside the plane. Take me inside as this plane impacts on the water. What was going on inside?
It was stone quiet in there, which was amazing to me because I don't think anybody cross-referenced what was going on. And I think that was a saving grace. And I just want to say, I admire your skills, but I honor the way you managed your state. And now I do listen to the flight attendants every flight.
Yes.
I know exactly where everything is.
Yes.
I know exactly where the exits are. And I know where that life preserver is.
I'm really proud of a dear, dear friend of mine by the name of Dave Sanderson. Every one of us got a hero inside. Every one of us has a capacity in the most difficult times to find our strength. And it's nice to see a miracle on the Hudson and know that part of that miracle was an extraordinary pilot. And another part of that was a dear friend who, even when he could barely function, made sure other people's lives were being saved and supported.
On January 15, 2009, another tragedy could have happened up in New York City. Instead, a miracle occurred. There were 155 people on U.S. Airways Flight 1549 and I, which was one of those that day that were blessed. Over the next 30 minutes, I want to share with you that experience, some of the things I was thinking, and two things that I think really contribute to that outcome, whether it was the power of faith or the impact of the American Red Cross, and how certainty and courage created a miraculous outcome out of a very chaotic and potentially tragic situation. But there is one thing I'd like for you to think about as I speak. The time that plane took off from LaGuardia, the time it crashed into the Hudson River, the time I got to the hospital was only about 30 minutes. And I wasn't scheduled to be on this flight. I was scheduled to be on the 5 o'clock flight that night. That day, I was working in a distribution center in Brooklyn, New York, in my job as a sales manager. Now, I don't know if anybody here has ever been or worked inside of a distribution center, but they normally open up quite early in the morning. This one opened up at 2 o'clock in the morning. So our day started about 5, we got done about 10. Now, I travel over 100,000 miles a year of what I do in my job, so any chance to get home to my wife and 4 kids a little early, I usually try to take advantage of that. So about 10 o'clock that morning, I called a travel agent, worked with her, and she put me on flight 1549. So I truly believe that I was just be on that plane for a reason. Nothing extraordinary about the day. It was 11 degrees and snowing. And I was one of the first set of passengers to board the plane that day because of my status with U.S. Airways. I was a chairman. I was top tier. So I went back to my seat. I went to seat 15A. That's 4 rows behind that left wing. And I did exactly what I did every single time I got on a plane then. And I hallucinate what you do when you get on a plane now. I went back to my seat, I put my briefcase down, I put my wallet in the briefcase, pulled the magazine out, and I started to read. I did not listen to the flight crew. I did not know where those exits were. I did not read that little brochure that I always tell you to read. But I guarantee you, every single time I get on a plane now, I do. because now I know how important it is to be aware on a plane. It was a little over 60 seconds after we took off is when I heard the explosion. And it was a loud explosion. Man, I had never heard anything on a plane like that before. So it got my attention. So I looked up, I looked out the window, and I saw fire coming out from underneath the left wing. So I knew something had happened, but I had flashed the wall, so I saw a plane lost an engine. No big deal. It really didn't startle me too much at that moment. See, that's where I think God's grace entered for the first moment in this flight, because knowing the plane knew at that moment in time what happened on the left side of the plane also happened on the right side of the plane. And I truly believe they were cross-referenced, checked in, what'd you see, what'd you hear? There could have been a lot of panic. People panic, people lose their heads. And when people start to lose their heads, they start making irrational decisions. But this day, 8 years later, the one thing that stays with me, and I bet if you talk to any passenger on that plane, they'll tell you the same thing. It was so quiet, you could hear a pin drop. But the guy next to me elbowed me and said, "Hey, man, what's going on?" So I think he's going back to LaGuardia. Funny banking, I thought he was just going back to the airport. But how fortunate we have a captain who not only had over 40 years of experience, 20,000 hours of flight time with a fighter jet pilot during Vietnam, and as important, if not more important, a first officer who also had 20,000 hours of flight experience. And a captain who was a certified glider expert, had to employ that skill called gliding to only save me and 154 other souls, but possibly the George Washington Bridge in New York. And as soon as he cleared the bridge, he said the only words he said the entire time on this plane. He said, "This is your captain. Brace for impact." And candidly, I didn't know what that meant. I didn't pay attention to instruction. But I know it's serious. Give you a heads up. You ever hear that one on a plane? Something's going down, and it's going down pretty fast. See, I think that was the moment, though, that everything that I learned and everything that I trained for start coming into play, because for the 10 years prior to that day, I was head of security for a guy by the name of Tony Robbins, that guy in that video. And I only had a chance to travel with him, but I learned and absorbed everything that he taught, in addition to everybody that he was with. So now I have the honor and privilege of going all over the world and sharing these lessons and strategies from that day. And my goal for you today is this. You might hear one or two things I'm going to share with you tonight that so the next time you face what I call your own personal plane crash. This might be a fire, a flood, a health scare, whatever that may be for you, that you don't be able to survive it, but thrive and grow from it instead of going into a depressed state like so many people do. Because one thing that I've learned is those who have the humility to prepare will have the confidence to execute when that moment comes. And as soon as he crossed over the bridge, I did two things. First thing I did is I prayed. I prayed, "Whoever that captain is, man, just get me down in one piece. I don't want to come back in multiple body parts. At least I wanted to end up in one piece." Second thing I prayed for is the last person I spoke with, who was my client up in Brooklyn, to call my wife to tell her that I loved her. And third thing is I prayed to God to forgive my sins. I don't want anything between me and God at this point. We're going down. I want to go up, and it ain't looking good for me right now. The second thing I did is I reached down in my briefcase and got my wallet out and shoved it down into my pants. Because if something did happen, it looked like it was probably going to happen. At least they could claim my body. At least my kids would know who I was. And now I put my head down. It was about 60 seconds after we crossed over the George Washington is when we crashed into the river. And it was a hard hit. He estimates you hit between 100 and 120 miles an hour. That's how hard a hit this was. So when he hit, I went all the way back into the seat and all the way up my seat, just like that. It was that hard of a hit. When I came back up, I opened my eyes and I looked out the window and I saw light. So I knew I had a shot, but I wasn't out. Because if you saw how the plane landed, the bottom of the plane was stripped off. And somebody actually did listen to the flight crew, went to that closest exit, which may be behind you, and tried to open up that door. So immediately, water started coming in from underneath the plane. Water started coming in from the back of the plane. So depending where you were on that plane, I was towards the back of the plane. Water was anywhere from ankle, knee to waist deep, just like that. Now the question I get all the time, in fact, I got it this morning in Miami. As soon as I got to Miami, the first question I was asked, how do these people get on these wings? I'm going to tell you how it happened. As I mentioned, when we hit, I went back in my seat. Some of the top of the seats broke back. And when that happened, people got extremely resourceful. All of a sudden, you saw people jumping up on top of the seats, walking down the seats. That's how most people got out. Now, about 4 years ago, I had the honor and privilege of speaking in Providence, Rhode Island, to a group of bishops and priests, a very unique audience. I got done speaking. One of the bishops walked up to me. He looked me in the eye and said, "Son, I think those seats broke because of divine grace." And I looked at him and said, "Sir, I don't know. I don't know." A few months later, I spoke in Groton, Connecticut, where they make the nuclear subs for the Navy. A very cool place. I get done speaking. One of the engineers walk up and say, "Dave, I think those seats broke because they are designed to break that way." I don't have a clue. So what do you do when you don't know something? You go to the wizard behind the green curtain, right? The wizard has all the answers. And I just happen to know who she was. She lives in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. I called her up and said, "Listen, I'm getting this question all over the country. Can you tell me? How did the seats break?" She goes, "We don't have a clue. They just broke." But that's how most people got off. But I didn't. I didn't think about getting on top of a seat. My game plan was get to the aisle, get up, and get out. That's exactly my first thought. When I got to the aisle, something happened that only changed that day for me, but probably changed the entire direction of my life. My mom kicked into my head. My mom had passed away in 1997. There was something she would tell me when I was a child that popped into my head at that moment, and it was, "If you do the right thing, God will take care of you." And the right thing for me was, you take care of other people first. See, I grew up playing sports and athletics and Boy Scouts. I was always around a group of guys. That's just how I grew up. He was always around a group of guys that hung together all the time. So you took care of each other. So I went towards the back of the plane to see if anybody needed help. And once we got everybody out, I started making my way out. Now you got to remember, not only did some of the seats break back, but the bins had broken open. Luggage has flown out. You're waist deep in the water. It's dark in the back of the plane. So every time you took a step, you ran into something. At that point, you can see, was it just a piece of luggage or was it somebody's body? What was it? But all the further I could get up, let's make sure this clicker works, it's 10F. And the first picture that was released on Good Morning America was me, the bald-headed guy trying to get out of the plane. But when I got to the door, though, it was an amazing sight. There was no room on that wing for me. There was no room on that boat for me. But it was an amazing sight. People were already being rescued. I don't know who said this, and I give them 100% of the credit, whoever said it, when they said that Skiles and Sullenberger got everybody down that day. The crew and passengers got everybody out that day. But the real heroes of the day were the first responders. And the first of the first responders was the New York waterways, the ferries. They were there about 2 minutes after his plane crashed. There's a lot of ways to define what a miracle is. Having someone there to rescue you after a plane crash in ice cold water in just a couple minutes, that's the start of a miracle. Now if you look at this picture really close, you'll notice I'm holding on to the lifeboat. And the reason why is this. I don't know if anybody here knows anything about the Hudson River. I've learned a lot about it over the last few years. It's got a very fast current. This plane actually floated down the river about a half a mile in about 24 minutes. So this little boat kept going in and out from the plane, and they, like, who reads the instructions? No one reads the instructions. It's actually tethered to the plane, but no one knew that. So they kept yelling at me, "Hold on, hold on." So that's why you see me hold on to the little lifeboat waist deep in the 36-degree water for about 7 minutes. And I sort of swung around, looked out the wing, and something happened to catch my eye. And it was a lady. She's holding on to a baby. In fact, I found out later she actually had two kids on this plane. She had a three-year-old on that lifeboat, a three-month-old she was holding on to. And she wasn't moving. And my first thought that I had was, man, if she tries to go on this lifeboat with this child, now you got to remember, not only is it 36-degree water, but now you got jet fuel all over the place. Now, I don't know if anybody here's ever walked on jet fuel. I'm going to tell you, it's slick. People slide all over the place. But my next thought was, how am I going to get out of here? She's standing in the middle of the wing, and she's not moving. So I just came to me what I did, usually what I did. To get people's attention, I yelled at her. I yelled, "Throw the baby, throw the baby." Now, candidly, I did not think she was going to throw a baby. I don't think that was a thought she was going to cross her mind. But what happened was I got her attention. And she looked at me, she's like, "What?" But it's amazing where people are in times of a crisis. Because now if you look at this picture really closely, you'll see a blonde-haired lady with her head turned to the right. She just happens to be a mother of three from Knoxville, Tennessee. She heard me yell this at this lady, looks up at the lady, says, "Give me the baby, give me the baby." All of a sudden she gives her the baby, jumps on the lifeboat, and all of a sudden you see people start walking down a wing. That lady sent me this package 4 years ago. The first thing was in there was a note that said, thank you for saving my family. But the second thing was a picture of the captain with that baby as a way to say thank you for helping her and her family. Now, I don't think I did anything spectacular by yelling, throw the baby. I don't think that was one of my finer moments. If you talk to my mother in heaven, she'll probably tell you it's one of the stupidest things my son ever said. I don't think the lady from Knoxville did anything spectacular. So I think the lady from Knoxville, or the lady who gave her a baby, did something pretty special. Just think how much faith. Talk about a definition of faith. To give your baby up to some guy who's yelling at you, some lady you don't know, and you give your baby up. And that takes a lot of faith. But I'm still on the plane. And things are happening all over the place. And there's one thing about people from New York and New Jersey. Any of you here from New York or New Jersey? I'm sure there are. They get a bad rap. There's one thing about people in New York and New Jersey, they know how to do one thing really, really well, is respond. Unfortunately, they've had to respond to things before. So they don't sit around and wait for someone to say, now, you go here, you go there, they go. And they start figuring stuff out. And one of those guys happened to be a tugboat captain. I got a chance to talk to him a couple years ago, hear his story. He said they put an all call out, all boats go. He brought his tugboat out, and he had a plan. He said his plan was he was going to bring his tugboat as close as he could to that wing, throw a rope to that lifeboat, have him tie it on, pull the lifeboat over to his tugboat, clean up the situation. Great plan. What he wasn't planning on is people standing on a wing. He couldn't pull the boat across. So you see where the boats are coming in from the front of the plane side. He got beeped out. Next boat's coming in. So he had to back his tugboat out to get out of the way for the next boat. He said as he was doing that, he hit the front of the plane. But Caitlin, that's not that big of a deal unless you're on the plane. And I was on the plane. Because you got to remember, 6-7 minutes into this thing, I'm waist deep in the water. And have you ever seen a tugboat? They're big, heavy boats. It shook the plane. When it shook the plane, I felt water go up my backside, and the first thought that I had was Titanic. I remember that movie. When that boat tipped up, it sucked everything down with it. And my thought was, immediately, do not be sucked down in a plane. You're this close to getting out of here. Do not be sucked down in a plane. So I stop here, and I thank my mom and my dad, because they hadn't given me swimming lessons from the Red Cross when I was a child. I may never be able to get off this plane. And that is one of the biggest lessons of that day for me and everybody else. See, I don't know if you have kids. I got four of them. And know you ever tell your kids to do something and they look at you like you're crazy, like, you want me to do what? Like you're crazy. So now I get the chance to talk to colleges and universities. I get to talk to kids. I tell these kids this. I spend a lot of time on this one point when I'm with kids. I tell these kids, just think of back when of Captain Stellenberger, when he attended the Air Force Academy. Does not learn how to glide a plane. Me, 154 of the souls and possibly the George Washington Bridge are not here today. Folks, somebody else is talking to you. I am not here. If my mom and dad don't make me learn how to swim, I am not here. Because one of the biggest lessons of that day is this for me and everybody else. All these things we learn all of our lives, 40, 50, 60 years ago. One day you may have to use that one skill to save yourself or save somebody else. The skill Stellenberger had to use that day was gliding. The skill I had to use was swimming. So I jumped in and swam to the closest boat that I could find and had to be into that wing. And anybody here seen the movie Sully? Anybody? Okay. That ferry you see there is actually one of the newer ferries. That had the metal ladders. You see the metal ladders. If you saw the movie Sully, it actually had the orange plastic ladder rolled down. Then when the older lad, that's the one kind I got to. So when I got there, I got my backside in. Now, you know, I'm climb, 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 and you know, can't. And then my mom started talking to me again. Because the word my mom hated most in life was the word can't. If you grew up in our house and you said, I can't to my mom, she said, if you can't do it, you're going to do it. Her mentality was, if you can't, you must. That was my mom's mentality. So I got one arm up, felt somebody grab it. Got the other arm up, I felt somebody grab it. To this day, I do not know who these two gentlemen are. But they pulled me on one of those ferries, threw me over the side. I'm sliding on the ice in the ferry. I don't know what's going on now. Now I'm yelling, get up, get up, get up. And I got to the side of the ferry. I'm like, man, I made it. But I didn't. because that was the moment. I've never seen these pictures of these firemen, especially firemen. I love talking about firemen. I love firemen. You see these firemen running into the fire, right? And the next thing you see of these firemen, they're sitting on the curb, right? They have nothing left. I had nothing left. I was so cold. I can't explain how cold 36-degree water is. It just takes it out of you. I was so cold. But once again, it's amazing where people are in times of a crisis. Because there was a guy on this ferry. He had a gray suit on. He had his laptop over his back, but most importantly, he was dry. But what did he have? He had an iPhone. He came up to me, put it in my face, said, call your wife, call your wife. And I couldn't dial the phone, but I could get the number out. And if I could handle this with one hand and getting iOS 10 to work, you will hear what was said that day from the ferry. Yeah, listen real close. Oh, let's do it again. I'll play it again because it's pretty hard to hear. You ready? That's all I could get out. This is your dad. I've been in a plane crash. Now, my wife's not waiting for me at home, waiting to give her blow by blow of what I do. She actually has a life. She's actually taking our son to basketball practice while this was going on. So my daughter, who then was a junior in high school, is the one who got that message. Turned on the TV, saw this breaking loose, and communicated this to my family. That's how my family found out. Now, anybody here not been in New York or New Jersey? Anybody? Few people. Okay, cool. This picture is great because it tells you pretty much where it happened. Quick geography lesson. So you look at this picture, right? The middle of that picture is the Empire State Building. Left of that, the big buildings are Manhattan. So if that side is New York, the other side of the river is Jersey. And 4 years ago, I had the honor and privilege of speaking in New Orleans with a gentleman who wrote the plan for maritime rescues of the Hudson. See, that plan was written years ago. They just got a chance to do it. And he and I spoke in New Orleans, plan execution talk. It was a very cool talk. I learned a lot of things. But one of the things I learned was pretty basic. Wherever closest point to shore you were is where you're going to go. So if you look at this picture, the left side of the plane is facing towards Manhattan. The right side of the plane is facing towards New Jersey. I'm heading to Jersey. And I found out later they radioed ahead because I knew I'd been in the water. So when we hit shore, there were three people waiting for me. Two EMTs and a guy from the Red Cross with a blanket just like this. And that's why I now speak all over the country and nationally for the American Red Cross. Because a little known fact about that day is this, which you will not get in the media. This is bonus information. There were a lot of groups that touched a lot of people that day. There were two groups that touched every one of us. The ferries, the waterways, and the Red Cross. Both the New York and New Jersey side. I couldn't walk. So they picked me up and carried me to a triage center. And if you've never been to a triage center, it's a room like this with nothing in it. There's nothing special about a triage center. If you put me next to the wall, strip all my clothes off down to my skivvies, that's underwear for you kids, okay? Just for what? It's underwear, all right? All the way down to my underwear. And all of a sudden, Heather, my EMT, says, I'll be right back. So I went to four of my underwear. I mean, I don't even know where I'm at now. I look over here, and there's a guy sort of like me. I look over here, and this girl didn't have any underwear on. But it's amazing when you're on the floor naked with two people, everybody's sort of looking, but no one's talking. It's a very weird feeling. It's like, okay, I'm on the floor with two naked people now. What's going on now, right? But I look up and look in the back of the room, and there's this guy walking towards me. He had a card in his hand. He comes up and says, sir, I need your name. I need your date of birth. And he writes on the card. He takes my right ankle, and he walks away. Now, I don't know when y'all grew up. I grew up in the 70s. There's a TV show called MASH. When they take your toe, they were carding you out. It was game over. You didn't make it. You're going to the big casino, right? It's done. That's exactly what I thought. I was on the floor. I was naked. I was ice cold. I had a tag in my foot. I must be dead. It's like that movie Ghost, right? You seen that movie where you're watching yourself die? I'm like, it's true. I didn't make it. I'm watching myself die. It's like, it's true. You watch yourself die. But all of a sudden, Heather comes back and says, I got to take your blood pressure. Good blood pressure. I need blood pressure now, right? Give me some blood pressure. Unfortunately, it was 190 over 120. She goes, we got to go stat. You could have a heart attack or stroke. We got to go right now. When they say stat, you're going someplace. And I'm thinking, I survived a plane crash. And I survived getting out of the water. And now I'm going to die of a heart attack or stroke. Man, it just keeps coming. So now they put me on this gurney. We are now, if you hear a stat, you're going fast. Put me on the gurney, wheel me out. There's this, all of a sudden there's like media every place. They're taking me to this ambulance. But there's a guy from NBC with his camera with his story. Last passenger out. And he's following us. They're trying to get me in the ambulance. He's jumping in the ambulance with us. There's chaos in the ambulance. I don't even know what's going on now. They're pushing him out. He's jumping in. They get the door shut. And they take me to a place called Palisades Medical, which is right down the street. And once again, people in New Jersey get a bad rap. When we get there, all of a sudden, there's like 20 or 30 people waiting just for me. And all of a sudden, guys in the room, guys, listen, 10 women with blankets ran up to get me. Because what happened was, I found out later, is the gurney got stuck because of all the commotion. So these 10 women come running up with blankets, pick me up, carry me to this bed where there is a doctor, and now it is go time. Because now the doctor's yelling out orders. He yells out, blood pressure. Take it again, 190 over 120. See, that wasn't good because Heather said I could die of a heart attack or stroke. That ain't good. They said oxygen. They yelled out 75. I didn't know what that meant. I found out later, that's not good. Then he says temperature, and I take it orally. It was 96, and he yells out aniline. All of a sudden, I got that one, right? I know what's coming out, whether I like it or not. It's coming hard, and it's coming fast, and I have no control over this one. But Nurse Bautista, who's on my right, who's my angel, she stayed with me the entire night, screams back at the doctor, I can't get him off, I can't get him off. Because I found out what happened, my body was so cold and so wet, the underwear basically were frozen, stuck to my hips. So is there a nurse in the room? Always a nurse. What do nurses always have? Scissors like this long, right? So she goes clip, clip, rip, right? All I got left is my watch, because my temperature was 94. That's how I got diagnosed with hypothermia, and it took them 5 hours to warm my body up. That's how cold my body was, 5 hours. I got to meet, that was amazing, 5 hours ago. I got to meet the former governor of New Jersey, the head of Port Authority, New York State Police, New Jersey State Police, Homeland Security, FBI. They all wanted to talk to me, and the guy who was on my left. He was the first passenger out. If you saw the movie, he was the guy who jumped in the water. He fell flat, fractured his sternum. And the reason they wanted to talk to us is this. A little known fact, which is this bonus information, which will not get in the media. I have 150 passengers, not crew, passengers. 10 of us went to the hospital. 7 went over to New York City hospital, like Beth Israel and Columbia, those hospitals over in the city. 3 of us went over to Palisades in Jersey. Out of those 10 people, 2 people stayed the night, Barry and I. 148 people walked home just a couple hours after a plane crash in ice cold water. So if you saw the movie, it's sort of represented really well, because they couldn't get a count. He kept asking, what's the count? No one knew where everybody was. And that's why it wasn't like 7 or 8 o'clock that night when the governor of New York came out and said, this is truly a miracle on the Hudson. Because they couldn't find everybody. Everybody gone home. But they could find us. And they had questions. And one of the questions I got was, do you think this was a terrorist attack? They have a plane going towards a bridge towards Manhattan. See, someone has to answer questions. And if you've seen the movie, you will validate it. The crew was locked up. You can get to the crew. No one knew who the crew was that night because they were locked up. So we were getting questions like this all night. But all night long, I kept telling the doctor, I have no clothes. I have no clothes. And the doctor said, well, why do you need clothes? You're in a hospital. See, I did not know you did not need clothes in a hospital. I didn't know that. I never stayed the night in a hospital. But what he didn't know is this. Not only did all the authorities know where we were at, but all the media knew where we were at. And we agreed to do Good Morning America, the early show on Fox and Friends. I had nothing to wear but my watch. So somebody from the Northern New Jersey chapter of the American Red Cross went out and got some really ugly sweats for me to wear that next day. And if you go to my website, you'll see the interview with those sweats. But that told me something. Somebody cared. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation when you have nothing. I'm talking you have no money. You have no clothes. You have nothing. And someone gives you, it's just a stitch of clothing. It's a big deal. It is a big deal. Now, if something like this happens, I hope you never go through it, but every airline has their own emergency response team, and each one of us got our own person, our own liaison. Mine was Doreen from Pittsburgh. Doreen flew in overnight. Doreen had one job, anything that I wanted, right? Take care of me. That's all she had to do that night. She got me some underwear, stuff the Red Cross forgot, right? Things forget, like underwear and socks, things like that, right? I finally talked to my wife, right? So all night long, we were up all night because media was coming in. She's pushing them out. So the next morning, I go do these TV shows. I come back, and I'm feeling pretty good now. I'm like, listen, let's go. I'm ready to go. She says, listen, I don't want any more stress on you. I'm going to put you on the 12 o'clock flight home. So I don't want to go home now. She goes, you understand I can't get you? I said, no, you don't understand. My wife and kids are probably freaking out. I want to go home now. She goes, no, you don't understand. She said, you are in Weehawken, New Jersey. You're going to LaGuardia. It's 9 o'clock. The flight leaves at 10. I can't get you there. I told you the night before, everybody wanted to be my friend. They all left their cars, said, call me if you need anything, and I cashed in. I'm going to tell you right now who the most important person in New York City is. The director of Port Authority. I gave his card to her. I said, call him. He said, he'd help me. She looked at me and says, call the director. I said, call him. He said, he'd help me. She said later, I thought you were melting down on me. Call the director of Port Authority, right? So she goes outside and calls the director of Port Authority. 6 minutes later, I had a police escort, ready to take me from Weehawken, New Jersey, to LaGuardia in 16 minutes in a pimped-out Escalade, me in my hoodie. They'll tell you, that is a miracle, right? And listen, if you ever have a chance to do a police escort through Manhattan, take it. There ain't nothing like it. Even Doreen, like, this is cool. This is really cool. Right through Manhattan. You know, 3 months ago, it took me 2.5 hours, right? You just can't get there if you've ever been in that part of the world. So now we're get to the LaGuardia, right? There's media there, but I just want to go home. Get me out of here. So I get up there, man. Listen, I had nothing to check. Let's go. Right? But we all forgot one critical detail. I'm included in this. We all forgot one critical detail. I didn't have an ID. How am I going to get through security without an ID? Homeland Security guy's card, the TSA, I played it. And he looked at me and said, sir, why don't I want to call the director of New Jersey Homeland Security? I said, he knows who I am. Please call him. He did. And I got the New York security without an ID. TSA will tell you that's a miracle. You try this at the airport, you end up with the Who's Gal pretty quick, right? They don't mess around. So now everybody wants to walk with me now, all right? So I got the entourage walking me down to the gate. There's a bunch of people down there, but they walk me right on, sit me right down in first class. So this is pretty cool. And all of a sudden, the captain and first officer come out, like, what's going on? He said, I deboarded the plane. He said, I want to talk to you. I've never talked to anybody who survived a plane crash. So I'm doing a little one-on-one interview here with the captain and first officer now, right? And they had questions. But what they weren't expecting, I had questions for them. Like, are you going to get me over this bridge? Are you going to get me home? Right? And the captain looked at me and said, sir, I do not have gliding experience. I said, whoa! Man, this is the first I ever heard of this one. He said, I do not have gliding experience, but I will get you home safe. What I'll do for you is this. When we hit 3,000 feet, that was the first time I ever heard that. I'll ring the bell so you and I will sort of know where this happened yesterday. So if you put me back in coach, I did not get first class. I did get free potato chips, free Coke. Beth, the flight attendant, great care of me. She took great care of me. Left the middle seat open. I put the hoodie up like the Unabomber, and I locked it down. I said, okay, get me out of here, right? Just get me out of here. But all of a sudden, I hear like ding, 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 and I look out the window. I'm like, man, 3,000 feet's not that high up. And that's when all this started coming back to me. That was the moment it started coming back to me. I started thinking, what happened? And that's when I realized what Captain Sullenberger did was amazing. The guy's a stud, all right? The guy's everything you see, he is. But what the first officer did, Jeff Skiles. He and I spoke at a Red Cross function in Chattanooga, Tennessee, 3 years ago. Very cool. They gave us 2 hours. From the plane, back of the plane talk. It was amazing to hear the whole story from the front to the back. And I learned a lot of things. But one thing I learned was pretty basic. You know, and if you saw the movie, this will validate it. People who saw the movie. Because the first officer has a book up there. How do you get down from emergency from 30,000 foot book? He did it from 3,000 feet. So he was telling Sullenberger step by step what was going on. He's as much a hero as Captain Sullenberger. But you rarely, if ever, hear about the second guy in command. He's as much a hero as Captain Sullenberger. We're on final descent to Charlotte. I haven't talked to anybody but Beth, the flight attendant. But the guy two seats over from me opens up page 4 of Newsday. And what is on page 4 of Newsday? That picture. So now he's looking at me. He's like, were you that guy on that plane? I'm like, what? So he shows me my picture. I'm like, man, my picture got in the paper. He goes, you were that guy on that plane. So he says it louder. So everybody gets up, look at the freak show with a hoodie in the back, right? Who is this guy, right? Now everybody's getting up to look at me. We're on final descent. The flight attendant's like, get down, get down. So Beth runs up and says, are you okay? I said, just get me off this plane last. Get me out of here. So when we landed, Beth, man, no one got by Beth. Beth was my angel, man. No one got by Beth. Get out of here. Just keep going. So she took me off the plane last. And yes, my family was there, and also the U.S. Airways was there to greet me. But also, the CEO of the American Red Cross in Charlotte was there with my family. And that was the most important thing that happened in that two-day period. I've had the high honor and privilege. I've been to Fort Hood. I got to go to Oklahoma a few years ago after the tornadoes. I went to the eastern shore of North Carolina after Superstorm Sandy. And I get to talk to people. And one thing I find out is this, and you as volunteers will appreciate this. People like me to get taken care of. But often the families are forgotten. And she was taking care of my family. And friends, that was the most important thing that happened in that two-day period. But that's where my miracle turns into my mission. And I'm going to end up and share with you, how does a miracle like this turn into somebody's mission? The Sunday after the plane crash, I went to my church. That Sunday, everybody wanted to talk to me. But there was one guy who really wanted to talk to me. He was in charge of men's breakfast. And he came up to me and said, Dave, will you speak at men's breakfast next Sunday? I said, no problem, man. 50 old guys eating pancakes? I got it. A walk in the park. A layup. I know they invited half of Charlotte. 500-600 people show up, and they run out of pancakes. They have hungry, angry Methodists. That's not a good combination. You might be all right for the Baptists and the Episcopalians and Lutherans. You can run out of food all day long. But man, are you any Methodists in here? I'll tell you, you got to have food, man, right? If you show up without food, you're not going to stay around long. So now I'm freaking out. So we got our gym and our stage is how our thing's set up, okay? So they had a curtain. I go behind the curtain and said, God, give me something today, man. Give it to me now. Deliver. And he gave me something to say. Now I got done speaking. Two men wanted to talk to me. One was from Bank of America. One was from Wachovia. They had people on the plane with me. I'm cool with that. But all of a sudden, I see this elderly lady, 80 or 90 years old, just locking me down, just staring at right at me. And all of a sudden, she starts making her way up. She interrupts the conversation. She grabs my arm really tight and looks me in the eye and says something that not only changed that day for me, but changed the entire direction of my life. She looked me in the eye and said, I was questioning if there really is a God. And I don't believe in miracles. But you are physical evidence that there is a God. And he does miracles. Thank you. She let my arm go, looked me in the eye one more time, just walked away. I look over these two gentlemen. I've never seen two men cry like this in my life, ever. My minister, who's in the back, he's actually the bishop of Florida now. He was witnessing all this. And I'm looking at him like, oh, what's going on? But all of a sudden, a few seconds later, it started coming to me. What happened to me on January 15, 2009, it now impacted somebody. Before she goes to her grave beyond, wherever that may be, please, there's a God who does miracles because I am physical evidence. So when I was invited to be here at Vero Beach several months ago with you tonight, there was no doubt that I was going to be with you tonight in Vero Beach. Because I don't know who I'm going to impact. You go back to 2009. There wasn't a lot of positive things happening in this country. But all of a sudden, you had a captain and a crew, and passengers that did something that had never, had ever been done in the history of aviation. One team, one goal, one miracle. It gave people hope. There's a passage in the Bible that says, suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. And that's not only what happened that day, I get to do that every single day now, but more importantly, the American Red Cross does that every single moment of every single day. See, I never thought that I needed the Red Cross. I gave blood. I did my thing. But all of a sudden, less than about 14, 15-hour period, I had three Red Cross experiences. And the most important was the one with my family. So I want to say thank you tonight. You know, I'm usually doing fundraisers. I'm usually asking for money for the Red Cross so they had money to do these things. But tonight, I'm here to say thank you. I'm honored to be with you because I know what you guys do. I get to go around the world now, and in Canada, the United States, specifically with the Red Cross, and I get to go out and see what you guys do. So I want to say thank you. Michael, I don't know where you're at again. I'm losing track of where I'm at. I don't even know where you're at, but I want to say thank you for having me tonight. Before I end, I just want to say may God bless you, and May God bless the Red Cross. Most importantly, right now, may God bless the United States of America. I'd be honored to take any questions if you have them, but thank you very much for having me. God bless you. Thank you.